Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining me today. I'm Faye Hutsell, Director of Product Marketing for Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. I have the pleasure of welcoming to the program Sriram Subramanian from IDC today for a discussion around the value of LCAS, local cloud as a service, effectively termed by the industry. And this correlates to Oracle's dedicated region, clouded customer, and the value of effectively harnessing the entire services of the public cloud within your own data center. So welcome, Sri. Good to see you again.
Thank you, Faye. It's my pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me here.
Absolutely. Why don't you start with a little bit around your background? What is kind of your infrastructure expertise? And ultimately, what is your role today over at IDC?
Absolutely. I'm Sriram Subramanian. I'm a research director at IDC, covering infrastructure and services. My primary areas of coverage are enterprise workloads, private cloud, and private cloud as a service, and AI-enabled workloads. In essence, my area is all spinning around how end users are consuming infrastructure, both on cloud and on premises, for their line of business needs.
Fantastic. And Sri, you recently authored a piece around the value of LCAS. And in that piece, you highlighted the increasing importance of hybrid cloud infrastructure and ultimately what it means to bring the entire cloud offering to a customer's data center, particularly when they have demanding residency and latency requirements. Can you tell us a little bit more about IDC's findings there?
Absolutely. IDC has been tracking the infrastructure consumption both on on-premises and cloud. And it is not surprising that the global adoption of cloud computing is interesting. One of the IDC's data points show that the consumption of public cloud infrastructure is going to beat or surpass that of on-premises. However, what we are also noticing is that majority of enterprise customers are adopting hybrid cloud. In one of the most recent survey, IISV 2020, about 60% of enterprise respondents mentioned that they're actively using hybrid cloud infrastructure. Now, what is interesting here is hybrid cloud platforms, the promise of hybrid cloud platforms provide them a choice of infrastructure based on the workload needs. Should they run a particular workload on cloud, or should they run a particular workload on-premises or on bare metal? Hybrid cloud platforms provide that choice. So that shows the growth on the use of hybrid cloud infrastructure among enterprises. Now, there is an other aspect to that, right? Like what is driving this? Traditionally, enterprise workloads have been limited to data centers, and the workloads tend to be more of consistent usage need. They had very special requirements on high availability, and you know the workload attributes limited where they can be placed. But with the growth of evolving use cases and applications like AI and ML, the location is changing. Where they can be placed is also changing. And that's where the promise of hybrid cloud comes into picture.
And that's very effective. That's interesting. So you also allude to the disappearing perimeter, right? Effectively, what is that perimeter and why is it going away?
Traditionally, perimeter refers to the data center premises. And as I just mentioned before, most of the enterprise workloads tend to be limited by the traditional data centers, right? And most of the enterprises, the IT processes workloads were under the assumption that workloads will be on premises, whether it is IT provisioning, whether it is service requests or troubleshooting, or even the tools and frameworks, they were all optimized around that. However, with the advent of cloud, the workload started moving away from the perimeter, moving away from the data center, right? So now enterprises have workloads both on-premises and cloud with a varying proportion, but that kind of expanded the scope of a perimeter, what a perimeter is. But that's just only one aspect of that. Now we are seeing more and more expansion of this location in terms of adopting edge use cases and edge locations. So now we have three locations, roughly put, right? The traditional data center, which is called as core, and then public cloud infrastructure, which is the cloud, and then the disparate locations of edge locations, right? So we have a continuum of cloud, core, and edge, and enterprises have their applications and workloads deployed on across all these things. Now, essentially, like what was the data center perimeter expanded to include the cloud, include edge locations as well. Thereby, really, there is no perimeter per se, but it's more of a continuum of cloud, core, and edge. That's what I referred by disappearing perimeter. And then, and to think in a different perspective also, right? Like, we're all working from home these days, and mm-hmm. the pandemic has changed the way that we socialize and we work. So really, like, you know, the workloads, the workforce, the assets, they're all getting distributed. And that's also another a side effect of or an influence towards this disappearing perimeter. Per se, there's no perimeter.
Interesting. That's helpful. The whole promise of the cloud, Sri, is to sort of reduce reliance on on-premises IT infrastructure and effectively, you know, private data centers. Yet, you know, it seems pretty counterintuitive, or it may, well, it seems that way, that we're bringing cloud services to the data center, but there is ultimately market demand or a necessity here, an implicit market demand. Can you tell us why you think this is happening?
Sure. And before that, let me also take a few moments to explain what this LCAS is or what local cloud as a service is, right? Earlier, we saw that an increasing usage of hybrid cloud. Right. We saw that what is driving that is basically the choice of the right infrastructure paradigm to place the workloads. But we are also observing an increasing pattern of customers wanting the as a service abilities, right? The agility, the business agility, and the scale that cloud provides. But they're also met with limitations on where their workloads can be. On one end, the perimeter is disappearing, the workloads are getting disparate. The other hand, they're also having regulatory restrictions or geopolitical restrictions on where their data can reside. So all these things brought in an interesting question. Now, I need the cloud. I need the as a service capabilities that the cloud provides. I also like to pay per usage, the OPEX model rather than CAPEX model, but I really don't want to leave that on-premises, right? That's when the promise of bringing the public cloud experience into the data center comes into picture. And that's what we call as local cloud as a service. Essentially, local cloud as a service is an offering. It's an on-premises offering, but the infrastructure is owned and managed by the service provider. And the end user consumes only the infrastructure services. They don't have the operational overhead. And then they don't pay upfront for the CapEx, but they're paying for their infrastructure consumption against their usage. So essentially, it's the promise of the cloud on premises. That's what we call as LCAS. And this is more like the proverbial, if the hill does not come to Muhammad, Muhammad goes to the hill, right? So we saw the need for the flexibility, scale, elasticity that the cloud provides, but we see the limitation of data and the applications not leaving the premises. And that's when the market responded with the LCAS offerings. And to begin with, it might sound counterintuitive. It might say that you're bringing in the data centers or you're adding to more data centers, but the operating words are as a service and pay as you go. With the LCAS model, the end user does not own the infrastructure. The service provider, in the case of ODRCC, Oracle owns the infrastructure and manages the infrastructure, so there is no management overhead. The end user consumes as a service, right? They just call programmatic APIs for provisioning and deprovisioning resources. And finally, they're paying against their usage. Granted, there are some nuances around minimal consumption or minimal commitment, all those things. But the key difference is that they are not spending their IT resources on managing this infrastructure. They are not having an upfront capex investments, and mm-hmm. they are only consuming what they want, and they're paying only for their usage. So that's the nuances of LCAS. So though it might sound counterintuitive to begin with, but the subtlety comes from as a service and pay as you go.
And why don't we talk a little bit more, do a double click here on the use cases of LCAS. And in your opinion, how do you think Oracle's dedicated region is actually catering to some of these use cases?
Thank you. Having said that, the LCAS market is very early on, and the customers that we talk to are primarily experimenting. And then given the ability to what they can run on, limited by what the market is offering, the primary use cases were seen to be around primarily like, you know, web scale or cloud native, or even like, you know, some of the traditional database enterprise workloads trying to move to LCAS offerings. But essentially, the services and abilities that were available with the market offerings earlier before ODRCC were limited to a subset of cloud services, right? But with ODRCC offering a complete set of cloud services, the users are in a position to run production case LOB applications. And on top of that, you know, essentially like to put, but whether it is traditional enterprise applications or applications that are trying to move to SaaS model through Oracle Fusion SaaS applications, or even integrating with their existing applications, right? And also your greenfield and net new applications. In essence, ODRCC appears to be able to satisfy or cater to the needs of varied heterogeneous workloads, both on production, greenfield, net new, and cloud native applications.
And would you say that that's how we're differentiating ourselves today with the competition, or is there more?
It is definitely one of your differentiations, given that you have made the OCI, the complete OCI portfolio available on ODRCC. That's definitely an advantage. The other thing also I'm seeing is the ability to keep the control plane on-premises, appealing to certain set of customers, not to everybody. Some customers may want to have the centralized control plane on public cloud, but there is going to be a set of customers who, for exactly the geopolitical or regulatory or restrictions, they cannot have their data and control leave on-premises. So ODRCC provides that ability to keep them completely offline if they want to, or airtight mode if they want to, right? And then finally, the comparison of compliance certifications. What Oracle is making available on ODRCC is also one of the key differentiators. So in summary, the three key differentiators that I see are a more enhanced set of, a complete set of cloud services, and the ability to integrate with SaaS portfolio as well, and an isolated control plane, and the compliance certifications.
Absolutely. You know, Sri, it's interesting, given some of these sort of newer solutions, such as Oracle's dedicated region cloud and customer and market, it's very likely that they're going to heavily influence the evolution of the industry. So what's next in this space for us? Where are we headed?
We are, no matter what, we are entering an interesting phase in the adoption of cloud computing. Having said that, I don't have a crystal ball in my hand, but without that, some of the predictions, some of the forecasts that we see are, majority of the workloads are going to be based on cloud-based infrastructure, whether it is cloud, public cloud per se, or cloud-based infrastructure such as ODRCC on-premises. And then more importantly, majority of infrastructure purchases is going to be in the small set of hyperscalers. So those two are very interesting trends that we are seeing. But you know, more importantly, what I expect to see is that given that it's early phase for LCAS, given that there is a good expertise and good learning from the last 10 years of cloud computing, I expect to see more and more end users taking more of a strategic approach in how they are seeing adopting cloud. I'm seeing them getting better at adopting right infrastructure, right location for the right workload. And that needs some improvement, and I expect to see that happening. So in short, expect to see the end users to gain more technology maturity and being more strategic about their infrastructure placement, workload placement. Majority of workloads getting into cloud-based infrastructure, and then majority of infrastructure purchase being limited to or being taken over by a small set of hyperscalers.
Absolutely. Great insights. Thank you so much for joining us, Sri. We really appreciated your time today.